So welcome to our online service for Sunday the 24th of October 2021. As you can see, it's our harvest weekend. Heavenly Father, we pray that as we gather in your name will be uppermost in our mind and on our lips. We pray, Father God, as we draw closer to you, that you will draw closer to us, and in the word of God and in our worship, Lord, we will touch heaven as heaven touches us. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Attributes of a loving Father, you're high and mighty, but humble all the same. You have made the heavens and the earth, and you made us in your image, Lord.
Now, as you can see, the display is looking rather good already. There is more to be added to that as we gather in person. And it's a delight to be able to say that the vast majority, all but a couple of pieces of this, will be going to the Basics Bank and blessing the hearts of those who need the services of that wonderful organisation. Now, as we take a closer look at the display behind us on the video, there'll be a song playing behind it, and I pray you'll be able to join in with that as well. It's a wonderful song. Give thanks with a grateful heart.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks
Praise God. And so, Heavenly Father, we thank you for every gift that is on this stage at the moment and those that are to come. We pray, Lord God, that every package, every gram, every ounce, every part of this display will go to blessing the hearts of those who need to have their hearts blessed. And we pray, Lord God, we don't wish to be recognized as individuals for the gifts we give. We pray that you will be on the forefront of people's minds as they receive these gifts. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. So we're going to turn to our reading for this Harvest Sunday. In fact, it's in two parts. It's two bits of the book of Genesis. Chapter 1, 28 to 30 says this. God blessed them, Adam and Eve, and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. Then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth and the birds of the sky and the creatures that move along the ground, everything that has breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food. And it was so. Then skipping over to chapter 9, verses 1 to 3, God blessed Noah and his sons, saying to them, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth. The fear and dread of you will fall on all the beasts of the earth and on all the birds of the sky, on every creature that moves along the ground and on all the fish in the sea. They are given into your hands. Everything that lives and moves about will be food for you. Just as I gave you the green plants, I now give you everything.
Like the frost on a rose, winter comes for us all. Oh, how nature acquaints us with the nature of patience. Like a seed in the snow, I've been buried to grow.
Genesis 1:29, then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it, they will be yours for food. And in Genesis 9:3, everything that lives and moves about will be food for you. Just as I gave you the green plants, I now give you everything. The two great excerpts from Genesis that we have read are very informative. And they have this in common for us to pick up on today. That is that God had the physical well-being of every single person and being at his heart, as well as our spiritual well-being, right there from the start. The first part from Genesis 1 has the first conversation recorded between God and the new human race in the form of Adam and Eve. And he tells them two things. Firstly, fill the earth and look after it. I'm giving you food from the ground and the trees. Skip forward 8 chapters and 1500 years or so, and with the flood waters having recently abated, God has a remarkably similar conversation with Noah and his family. Fill the earth and I'm giving you food, but now from the animals as well as the ground and the trees. Now, whether or not that feeds into the vegetarian, vegan, carnivore debate is a matter of your conscience and perhaps a discussion at a further time, but it's not where we are today. What I'm thinking about here from both episodes is that giving us food to eat and looking after the planet was as much in the heart of God from the very beginning as having children was and looking after the families that came with them. He was and is serious about both things. So serious that he committed himself to delivering good food for us. Not just talking about it, but delivering it. Just before that conversation that he had with Noah and his family, we find this in Genesis 8:22. As long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease. Now that should spark a responsive heart in us, a heart of thanksgiving. If he's anything like us, surely God will delight in us being thankful for what we actually have. I love it here in Sunshine Corner, and I used to enjoy it when my children were small as well. When the kids ask for their drinks and their toast and their cereal, using that please and thank you that their parents have taught them so well. Manners that have been passed on from generation to generation and are still very much a part of our vocabulary, I'm pleased to say. There are times though, and probably quite a lot of times actually, where we are more likely to bemoan what we don't have or what we prefer to have than what we've actually got. Isn't that terrible? But we all do it if we are to be honest with ourselves. Our example should be Jesus, who showed a grateful heart, even when he was facing death, giving the disciples that bread and wine at the Last Supper, and thanking God for those emblems that represented his own broken body. How incredible is that? I'd like us to think today of three R's that we need to consider as part of having a thankful heart. Response, reciprocation, and restitution. A thankful heart is a response to the generosity of the giver, isn't it? The celebration of harvest is based on understanding that we owe what we have to God, as well as to those who grow, produce, transport, stock, and sell us the produce. Most of us are not living hand to mouth in the way that perhaps our forebears would have done in a much more agricultural time. By faith, we understand that all good gifts around us are sent from heaven above, as the old hymn says. That may not be terribly fashionable, but it is our faith. How great is the God who not only designs and creates us, but also manages to create the fuels that keep us going, which we have a huge choice of and which we enjoy. That's hardly the act of a stingy, parsimonious God, as some people try to portray him. It is indicative instead of his extraordinary, limitless love for us. Summed up beautifully in this verse from Matthew 6, 26. Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? The answer is yes. That has to be a cause for celebration. Not just because provision has been made from the generosity of the heart of God, but that provision is driven by love that is so powerful that he has promised that it will not fail. Get that? At least not until he blows the final whistle on time. It never has failed. Whilst there have been shortages in various places around the world from time to time, there has always been enough food. It's just that some have had too much, whilst others haven't had enough. And we have not distributed that food as well as we ought to have done. We do need to point out that response to the wonderful people who bring it to us is also required. Those who bring it from field to fridge, from sea to shelf, from producer to plate. And until very recently, I think we've taken that all a bit for granted, haven't we? Well, not anymore. Now, response surely must lead us to reciprocation. Not just by returning thanks, but by being as good to others as others and God are to us. It's why we as a church encourage the purchase of things like free trade items. We reduce waste where we can. We buy from our local corner shop or from the local supermarket or from the cash and carry that is in Eastleigh, providing local jobs for people. We think that's part of our ministry to the area and we take it seriously. Now, according to this snappily titled webpage, the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization believe that the world grows enough food even now for 1.5 times the entire population. 1.5 times the population. How good is that? That places an enormous responsibility on those who have the largest share of what the world has to work for the betterment of those who have less to make sure there's something more of an equality in the food supply chains. Now, it might sound rather counterintuitive, but you see, there's a principle here that if you want to gain more, you've got to give more. Strange, isn't it? If you want more, pass that love on. It is a biblical principle that the more we increase the well-being of others, the more we will increase our own. There's a remarkable verse in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 6, verse 38. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Wonderful. With the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Fantastic, isn't it? The people we share our country and indeed our planet with are equals in the sight of God. God has no national favourites. And his promise that seed time and harvest would not fail was not confined by any borders. It's interesting to note when this promise was given, there were no nations, not even the nation of Israel, had been formed at that point. So this was a promise for the whole of humanity. Brilliant. Should anyone ever feel that other people are somehow less deserving? I touched a bit on this last week. It is not so. Remember that we have a biblical injunction to love our neighbours as ourselves, which ties in with that wonderful statement in Luke, with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. It applies to our international neighbours too. Because God has given to us, it is for us to give to others. If being given something gives us the responsibility to give, it also gives us the responsibility to be restorative, to look after what we have, not to squander our resources unnecessarily. And that's where things like our recycling bin, as humble as it is, come into play, amongst other measures. Going back into the book of Genesis, chapter 2, verse 15, the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. Eden was there for Adam and Eve's prosperity and for posterity. When we are given gifts, it becomes our responsibility to care for them because they were given to us in love. We tend them in love. Reduce, reuse, recycle may be a modern thing. Another one of those three-word phrases that we talked about last week. But it is also utterly biblical. It is not a woolly liberal thing. It's about God's love for our planet. In love, he made the earth and saw that it was good. In love, he gave the planet into our care. And in love, we should tend it and make sure we don't cause any disruption to it or as little disruption to it as we possibly can. Why do we need to take this seriously? Well, among the thousands of reasons this harvest, just remember this. The writing of the Apostle Paul from Colossians 1, 16 and 17. For by him, by God, all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He created it for us, and we are stewards of his creation, thankful for the use of it. We don't own it. We are just custodians of a bit of it for the time that we are here. Don't be fooled by any document that tells you that you've got a freehold of the land, because actually you haven't. We are all tenants on this earth, and God is our landlord. It was created for him as his footstool, so we are the keepers of his house in that sense, and privileged to share the glorious blessings that it brings to us. It's just a brief consideration of our response, reciprocation, and restitution duties. These are all matters of our heart because they are matters of God's heart. They are matters for us to consider when we benefit from God's goodness to us on a day-by-day basis, because they are matters that he considers for us on a day-by-day basis. Now, we don't often delve into the book of Lamentations, but when we do, and I close with this, it is worth doing so. Lamentations 3, 22 to 23. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is God's faithfulness. So as we close our service after hearing those wonderful words from Lamentations in our mind, let's just consider, Lord, how great thou art.
See you.
And so as our time together online draws to a close, let's just pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the truths that are in your word. I pray, Lord God, that you'll help us to search the deeper things of these words. Father, I pray you'll help us to look deeper into what you have in mind for us by perhaps checking those scriptures. Father, I pray again that you will cause us to be blessed and be a blessing. Blessed because of what you've given us on this earth, and a blessing by passing that blessing on to others. In Jesus' name, amen. And so the Lord bless you and keep you, make his face to shine upon you and give you his strength until we meet together again in 7 days' time. Take care.